March 2020, I was in Brooklyn, New York with my band Life, heading into what should have been our busiest year to date, when suddenly everything was cancelled and I found myself back at home in Hull, East Yorkshire, with no clue what the future would hold. It was then I found myself agreeing to record a series of podcasts from my spare room, with a simple goal to reconnect, to catch up, to check in with musicians and friends I have met along the way. So I made a few calls and even fewer notes and just pressed record. My name's Stewart Baxter and you're listening to Keep Talking, a podcast brought to you by SOUNDSPHERE magazine. Back in August 2020, I had the pleasure of catching up with one of my biggest inspirations, Jehnny Beth. I first witnessed Jehnny performing with their band Savages on the Jools Holland TV show back in 2012, a performance that made the hairs on my neck stand up and that I talked about for weeks, months and even years afterwards. I quickly realised that everything Jehnny went on to do was going to blow my mind. Oh, this is who I am. In this conversation, we got talking about anxiety and mental health and how this plays a part in art, Jehnny's home and early life growing up in a theatre, working with Atticus Ross and Flood, her long-term relationship with her partner and collaborator, Johnny Hostile, and how it felt to release her debut album and debut book in the middle of a global pandemic. Jehnny is a sweetheart and a kind soul, an unparalleled artist who doesn't ask for permission or forgiveness. Here is my conversation with Jehnny Beth. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. I always have to think about when people ask me that question nowadays.
I know.
You know what I mean? I'm so used to going, yeah, I'm fine. But then you're like, am I fine? Am I okay?
Yeah.
Relationships and conversations have become, in my opinion, more honest. So, I feel like I've become more honest. So I think I'm okay a bit more. I'm okay now to be saying, to talk a bit more about how I feel rather than say I'm fine.
So let me ask this question again. How are you?
Well, if I'm truly honest, I'm feeling a bit anxious today.
Okay.
The coffee probably didn't help that. But
I'm anxious if I don't have coffee.
Yeah, well, this is it. I think anxiety, I feel like I'm using that word a lot recently, but maybe I'm more aware of it, you know?
Yeah.
Because you realize that you carry anxiety through everything that you do, especially if you care about it, you know, whether that's relationships or work or life in general.
Yeah, but I've learned that actually anxiety is, as you say, it's a really great way of saying it, carrying it with you, whatever you do, you know. But actually I've learned that even if I feel anxious, it doesn't stop me from making things happen. And the anxiety is here, it's a companion. It comes in, it comes out. And I try to not let it stop myself, because I actually look back and I have done tremendous things through, even though I was feeling anxious. And sometimes I think you have to let the emotions be and just, it's uncomfortable, right? I mean, it is, but actually you can still do things and you can still be yourself and things keep moving forward, even though you feel that. So it's all about not really listening to, it's not listening to your emotions, because you acknowledge it's here, but it's more about not let them control you, maybe.
Yeah, and do you think it's about using that energy differently?
It's about compartmentalizing, maybe. I can't say that word.
Yeah, compartmentalizing. it's a hard word.
Because I mean, I've had anxieties that completely would stop me. You know, you have difficulty to breathe. Yeah. You have, you know, all these things. But I think if it's an anxiety that you know that you're able to control, that you've learned that, you know, it's here. It can be a shock at the beginning, but once it's, I mean, I've always had the same type of anxiety, so. Maybe that's why I say that, because then I recognize it when it comes, and I've learned to let it be and know that it will pass, like anything.
Yeah, I think I've had a similar experience with anxiety. I think when I learned through therapy, I learned what it was and what the triggers were, I suppose. Or even if not what the triggers were, but when a trigger happened that made me anxious, I suddenly felt so much more empowered when I knew it was happening, because then you can control it, like you say, or you can sort of choose. Because before, if you don't know why or when it's happening, that's when it's a shock and it makes you more anxious and it makes you feel, wow, what's going on? You know, why do I feel like
this? Yeah, and all your focus goes onto it. Yeah.
Yeah, and you can use it, like you said, about you've achieved some, you know, amazing things in your life, and knowing that it was like, you know, you was feeling crippling anxiety or whatever. I know for me, I joined the band Life at one of the, you know, the worst points in my life when I was feeling, you know, I'd lost both my parents at the time.
You still did it.
Yeah. And it almost, you know, joining the band was like a therapy for me. You know, it was, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to do something. I'm going to do something positive with this energy, you know, because you can spend so long sat at home or feeling sad, but I'm lucky, I guess, to be the sort of person that I can't do that for too long before I have to do stuff. Is that how you feel? Like you kind of feel like you've got to be doing something to change how things are?
Yeah, I think, as you said, I mean, the action is what takes you out of, you know, you change your context, you change your surrounding, you act in life, and then that's what will change how you feel. I don't think you can change really how you feel without any sort of action.
And throwing yourself in at the deep end. I feel like you know, what I do know about you, and when we've met, I feel like you're the sort of person that does do that, you know. And it's that, you know, the thing of when something, an opportunity arises, or when you've got to do something, and sometimes that anxiety arises and you think, can I do this? Should I do this? And then you think, you override it and go, that's the whole reason why I should do it, because it is scary. It is, you know, anxiety inducing, but that's almost right. I need to overcome this. This is a reason to do it almost.
It's about accepting to be uncomfortable and not trying to do things just because they make you feel comfortable, you know. It's the same with love and relationships. I think it's not always about, oh, I love these people, they make me feel great. I mean, of course, you know, the company of others should make you feel good, but also it's about going through difficult patches. And I think those difficult patches are not just a sign that you're in the wrong place. It means that you're actually pushing something, because any transition is painful, as you know. I mean, you just mentioned that you lost both your parents. I can't even imagine how that must have felt. But that's a transition, isn't it? So how the person you were before you had your parents and the person you were after is a different person. I mean, it's reinventing who you are. So I can't even imagine how that must have felt, like that transition moment.
It's a really beautiful way of looking at it, really, I think, is in a transition, because that feels like a positive thing, you know.
Yeah.
Transition. you know, where sometimes people are scared of the word change, but I guess the word transition seems a little bit nicer. You know, because then it makes you feel like a butterfly or something.
Yes, I like that.
But yeah, that definitely, I mean, you're right, that's kind of how it felt for me. I felt like a different person beyond those traumatic events in my life, but I wouldn't change any of it. And I see a hell of a lot of positives in those things as well, you know, and I've got a lot of positives out of those moments. So, you know, I'm definitely somebody who embraces that and puts that into my creative side, I guess, into what I do.
Yeah.
Well,
there's two ways of looking at, you know, death. Is the way it can induce more life, or the way it can take you down and below the ground, you know. So it's a matter of, I've seen, you know, people who I really love and who I feel have a really great spirit, and that I include you into that, is often people who have been, close to death and who have understood what it means to be living, you know, because the disappearance of even the earth is something that we need to acknowledge and in order to be able to say, I have lived, you know.
That's really interesting way of looking at it, you know, that loss of, it's not just people, is it? It's, you know, and what's around us. And especially, I think, 2020, you know, although I'm sure we've had a lot of conversations about it. And, you know, one of the reasons I'm doing this podcast was because of, you know, some of the issues we've had and been stopped to change how we're doing things, and which is great in many ways. But, and I didn't want these conversations to be about COVID-19 as such, but 2020, even before this lockdown period, for me, I was fortunate enough to be in Australia over Christmas time with my family.
Nice.
But it felt like on January the 1st, 2020 already felt like a quite sci-fi year. Mm. Do you know, just the number 2020 is quite sci-fi. And waking up on January the 1st and being in Australia, the world was literally on fire, you know.
Yeah.
It was burning.
I know.
And, you know, and then it seems like it's been on fire ever since, maybe metaphorically or, you know, literally.
Absolutely.
How have you found 2020? I mean, it's a big question, but...
No, I understand. I mean, it's amazing, your story about Australia. I think you're right. It just, from January 1st, it started burning. It's a strange feeling. I think personally, I felt similarly to you before the lockdown. So my father got ill and was in a coma, and he was in a hospital for months, and I was there, so I cancelled everything. I was obviously preparing for the release of my record. I cancelled my trip. I was going to LA to shoot a video. Things were happening, but I shut down everything and I went to my family. So it already felt that something was going on that was really not what I expected about this year, because 2020 for me was going to be about releasing all this work and material I had been working on for the past 3 years. I had been quite low-key and quiet, and then 2020 was about touring, releasing a record, releasing a book, doing a TV show. You know, it was it was all about all these sort of outputs and the outside world, you know. When you're an artist, there's the inside world when you're creating, and you sort of shut down yourself sometimes from the outside world. And then this was going to be about outside. So I was sort of forced inward again, but I'm grateful for the experience. I mean, first, my dad survived, so I'm very, very thankful for
that.
He's
okay.
Well, he's damaged, but he's alive, which is a miracle. And that, you know, it's sort of, I've started writing again. So I released my record and I've started writing again, because obviously I can't tour. So this past few weeks, it was painful at first because I felt I was mourning, something. I was mourning the life that could have been. And I think a lot of people can recognize themselves in that.
Yeah. And you got a taste of it, didn't you, as well? You did. I mean, how many gigs did you do before this?
Two.
Yeah, exactly. So that's almost worse in a way, isn't it? Because you like got the band to a point where you was ready. You did those shows and they were amazing shows. And then like, you can almost feel that kind of that you want to burst, you know, that energy of like, right, we're ready to go. And then it gets taken away from you. But like you said, you just can't take it personally, because you're literally in the same situation as every other artist in the world. So it's almost like, I feel like, although we're all mourning for that kind of our lives and the being out and making music, and it's almost, there's a lot going on, and a lot of people are going through same situations. A lot of people are going through much, much worse situations, aren't they?
Exactly. So. And it's a test as well. I think it's a test of your endurance, of how much you want to do it. I mean, that's always the Bukowski poem I always go back to, you know. If you're going to try go all the way, otherwise don't even start. It could mean losing relatives, friends, family, you know. even losing your job or even your mind, and you know, and that's the idea of, you know, it's a test of endurance. It's a test of, you have to keep going, you know, what else are you going to do?
Yeah. And I think with, artists and creative people, we're very resilient people, right? Yeah. So I had a similar chat with Simone Marie, and we was talking about how, you know, as artists, we are, you know, before any of this happened, before you was in a band, before you was, you know, successful or however you want to call it, you was making stuff because you had to make it because that's who you was. Nothing stopped you, and there was a lot of barriers, you know, and so whatever happens, you know, we're very resilient as artists. And I feel like you, even though you, I'm sure you've, your experience has been different, you know, as it always is in your own life, but from the public perspective, you know, it seems like lockdown happened, but you still charged on, you know, the album came out, the singles, you maybe changed your plan, but you didn't seem to stop. You seemed to just get busier, and then a book came out, and you know, so I feel like you almost like, you know, it feels like it was very inspiring to me, I'm sure other people, but to watch you just kind of put that energy and into positive creation, and also to talk about it in a way that was so honest and real, but you know, but very productive as well. And that, I think that was a great response. I'm sure it wasn't that easy in real life. But.
I mean, you know, I thank you for and I'm glad it's inspiring. I mean, I get inspired by other people, and I see their resilience and their energy. I have to say I'm not alone, you know, and I think that's why it keeps me going as well. I've got an amazing team of people working, and also you do it for them. You do it for the people who've put all the work into it, from the musicians, the producers who worked on the record, from, you know, the labels and the publishing house who released the book, the management, the, you know, they're all great people, and they're human beings, and they've feed me their energy as well, and their enthusiasm and their excitement. And I have to say also I was fueled by the reception of the record, because I have never had so many great reviews on a record, and I've never had such a, like, it was a home run. It was like, I felt very, very accepted, you know, and to be completely honest, I know I sacrificed that record in some kind of way. I know, because it was released in this year, there were many things that I couldn't do, like TV, like, you know, there's so many things to make more people know about this record. So in a way, I know I was sacrificing a part of this record. Like, it was not going to be heard by as many people as it could have been if it was a normal year. But what I believed in is I was thinking, you know, it's a great record, and I feel very, very confident about the quality of it. And I've never made this record just for 2020. I made the record, and that was my first intention, for the 10 years coming ahead, and more than that, and even after I die. You know, this record is going to stay after me. And so in a way, I was happy to sacrifice, like, maybe parts of it, but for me, it was not the whole story or journey of this record was not the release date or how much it will be selling on the first week. Because it was never about that. I mean, this record is about, To Love Is To Live is about creating foundations. Foundations for myself and investing in myself and starting building from then on. So it was important that it was coming out and not delayed more, because I need to start building. You know what I mean?
It says a lot about you as an artist, though, that you look at, regardless of, you know, the world situation, but that you look at your record as, you know, this has got to last forever. And I think you know, the people that do that make timeless records. And some of those records, you know, people don't understand for 20 years sometimes, you know. Some records in the past, as you know, have been released to no critical acclaim. Everyone said it was rubbish. And then 20 years later, it's become a, you know, one of the best records in the world, because maybe it was ahead of its time. I don't know, but it's great that you looked at this record like that. And when you look at it like that, it does kind of make you think, well, actually, this year it doesn't matter where it goes this year because it's going to be around forever.
Yeah, and I was working with Atticus Ross on the record, and he very much thinks like that. I think he helped me to also start thinking like that. He would, he's a master of details as a producer. He would go on, you know, work for hours on trying to sync the voice with the music, details that only he can hear. But his point is always that this is going to stay forever. So you gotta make it the best it can be. And I think, especially with, I mean, for all the album, but for sure with the tracks I worked with Atticus Ross, I felt that's really what we achieved. So in a way, I feel my shoulders are, I can take anything, you know, going back to that resilience thing, but my shoulders are strong. I've built it. It's not like, it's not like I did it in a rush as well.
I know you talk a lot about the collaborators and everything I've seen you doing when I've, you know, spent time with you. When we did the Echoes show, or when you invited me to the I'm the Man video shoot. And when you talk about the album, I really see this kind of how much you involve people in what you do, but not just involve them, like, you know, everybody has a team, but you seem to really, you know, you really go out your way to credit and involve your collaborators. And whether that's somebody who's got the smallest job or the biggest job, whether it's the producer or, you know, somebody emptying the bins. I don't know. You seem to have a real, like, way of inclusivity, you know, including everybody in the process. So even when on Echoes or on a video shoot, which is very, very stressful.
Yeah.
And it's, you're kind of trying to look, you know, make sure everything's okay, but you're also trying to be the presenter, the artist. I felt like you still managed to make everybody feel equally as important and that their role in the process was equally as important. And how important is that to you to involve people like that? Because it's a rare thing, really, I think, you know?
It's a very, very nice thing to say. And I thank you for that. It's it's quite emotional to hear this, actually, because I'm so thankful that you saw this, you know, because I'm not really conscious about it. I think I do it naturally, but I do think it matters to me a lot, and I do believe that. I love a group effort. I love when people come together and do something, and I think that comes from my youth, my parents were, into theater. My dad was a theater director. And he had a company, and there was always a lot of people in my home, a lot of parties, but also a lot of people coming for dinner, talking about new projects. And it was always, you know, the troupe, the idea of the theater troupe or group, is something that I grew up with. And after school, I'd go to the rehearsals and I'd see them, you know, the light person and the, you know, the costume person, the director, my father, actors, you know, the person making the food. My father would treat everyone the same. And they will be all part of this family and, you know, share laughs and share moments of despair or moments of failures, moments of, you know, of success. And I think it's in my backbones. I think it's really in my DNA. And when I'm on the shoot, whether I'm on a TV show, whether I'm doing, you know, or in the studio working with different people, the assistant, the person making the food, the person, everyone is, I think it's important that they bring their own interest into what's going on also, you know, it's more about everyone caring, because especially when you're in the studio, I mean, I'm sure you feel that way as well. Like, you don't want someone who doesn't care in the room.
Yeah.
Even if it's just a person who's bringing everyone food, that person needs to be, you know, usually in studios, they sit in the corner and they're very quiet but you need to feel that if they start yawning, you know, I notice, you know, I don't want him to be bored. I want him to feel like he's excited about what's going on and doesn't want to miss a thing.
Well, you see the value in everybody's energy and everybody in the room. And I think, like you said, it kind of makes more sense when you talk about being brought up around theatre, because that is tends to be a world where that can happen. And not everywhere, I suppose, but it sounds like your father was really good at involving everyone and really realising that the success and the beauty in what you're doing is the sum of its parts, which, you know, it's stronger together. So if one of those parts, one of those pieces of the jigsaw is not happy or is, you know, then it's going to fall apart. And I think that's, you know, that's a really valuable thing. And it's really great that you do that unconsciously, I guess.
I like working with people who are good at what they do and they know they're good at what they do, but who are grateful, you know, to be there. And that energy is if you are at that space at that moment in your life where you're proud of what you're doing and you're trying to do the best job and you're very grateful to be there, then we can go anywhere. We can do anything. If that's the mindset of the person, then it's I don't care who they are. I don't care where they come from. I don't care. We can go miles. We can go for years, you know. And I've actually worked for people for years. I've actually kept some of the people I've been working with. Some date to 15 years now. And I've lost people on the way, of course. But I feel that if you're not a cunt, basically.
Which is a simple philosophy in life. Don't be a cunt.
Don't be a cunt. That's it.
But I think the simple things of like just in, like you say, involving people, thanking people, but it's not just that, it's about meaning it, you know, so.
Oh, there's a weird sound coming out of my computer. Wait.
That is weird. That's gone.
Sorry.
Oh.
Oh, that is interesting.
Yeah.
Hang on. I think it's just my
sound effects.
Fan. Yeah, it's the fan of my computer.
Oh, it's okay.
It's a sign of decay. I think my computer is saying...
Digital decay.
Yeah. It's saying it's a bit old now.
Doesn't
Sorry.
Like it. It's saying, not another interview, Jehnny. Come on.
Exactly.
Give me a break.
Done so many. We've done so many together. It's a good companion.
Yeah. I guess what I was alluding to there was that, you know, a lot of people can say the things and, you know, check and everyone's okay. But I think, I guess what I get, I see in you and other people do, I guess is it's believable and you mean it. So when, you know, when we turned up to Echoes and you looked us in the eyes and said, do you need anything? You know, are you okay? Can I help? But then when you did that, the 10th time, we was like, Jehnny's so, you know, she really does care. You know, you care. But anyway, we will stop making you feel embarrassed. But it's just a good thing. I guess the point was really about collaboration, and you was talking about, you know, the album, and I've heard you and read interviews with you talking about a lot about your collaborators and how important they are in the process and putting value on their input, you know, because they've brought a lot to this. This isn't the Jehnny Beth album, is it? This is a lot of people have put a lot of work into this.
Yeah, I mean, it is the Jehnny Beth album, but I do not, you know, sometimes there's this preconception about a strong woman is a woman who does everything herself. When a man who collaborates is a powerful man, an influential man, you know what I mean? Like there's this sort of... So I always want to, you know, say things that people don't say. So for me to say I'm collaborating a lot and this is still a Jehnny Beth record is sort of showing my weakness, what people would perceive as a weakness, because they want to see a woman who produces herself, writes herself, records herself, comes up with all the concepts for her videos herself. You know, it's fine. I think a lot of people do it really well, but also I see sometimes the limitations of that because not all of us are prints. You know what I mean?
definitely not.
Definitely not. And thank God for that, you know, because Prince is pretty unique. But I know my own limitations, and I accept what I'm interested in is the good idea. I'm looking for the good idea, and it doesn't really matter where it comes from. It doesn't matter if it comes all from me. It doesn't matter if I'm not going to feel embarrassed. You know what I mean? But also, yeah. It doesn't matter if it comes from somebody else. And if that person is okay to for their ideas to be used, then I will use them. You know, I don't have any ego into this. What I'm interested in is the best possible thing, you know, the best possible outcome. And I think some of my favorite artists are great collaborators. I mean, you think about Bowie, you think about, you know, there's people who've learned or knew how to get the other people in, you know.
Yeah. And they saw the strengths and what they could bring and how we could, they could work together to make something stronger.
Yeah, without losing their own identity as well.
Yeah, and like you said, it's about really understanding how to use the ego and not making that about, well, I didn't create it. So
yeah.
It's about honouring the song and the art and thinking, yeah. How could this be the best it could be? And it seems like you've captured that really well by working with some, like, obviously some unbelievable people that you must have been blown away to even collaborate with. And you mentioned Atticus Ross, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, Trent Reznor is somebody, you know, I've admired Nine Inch Nails, you know, my whole life. Yeah. I've been into that band and I've seen them play live. And
yeah, me too.
That really made me realize something about collaboration when, you know, he became a permanent member of Nine Inch Nails.
Yeah.
Because that says a lot about, you know, him and Trent and giving that kind of power away. Because I know Trent seemed like somebody who had a lot of control and did everything.
Yes.
And he saw something and he saw an opportunity to move forward by collaborating with Atticus. So
yes. Yeah.
That's a great example.
A perfect duo. And the way they work is very interesting. I mean, I don't know all of it because it's still a mystery to it. But Atticus,
which is great.
Yeah, which is great. Atticus has told me about, you know, their sessions and how they work. And I don't know everything, but there's some parts of it I think are very interesting. And there's a great level of trust. I think Atticus is a real perfectionist, is a real aesthete, you know, and he cares so much and there's a level of perfection in what he does. You know, it's like a high-end architect, you know. That's how I see him. And Trent Reznor, I think I've never met him, so I can't really say more, but I think he put a lot of, he's seen that in Atticus, and I think they've both, he's found a perfect collaborator to move forward as well.
And that's what it is. It's moving forward and seeing the kind of opportunity and the value in that. I think when you worked with Atticus and a lot of other great people, like collaborators, like you're saying, the people that you felt you was working with and they were going to bring something special. There must have been a lot of really special moments. Is there anything that springs to mind when making this album where what kind of really pushed a boundary or made you think, wow, I've never felt like this before? Or
yeah. Of course, working with Flood in London was particularly challenging. He arrived on the project at the end. I had worked with Atticus Ross. I was looking for, I had worked with Johnny Hostile, who was producing, he's co-writing most of the record with me, but he was producing songs as well. We were listening together, Flower, and a lot of great songs, How Could You? And then I was looking for a third producer because there were songs I wasn't really happy with and I felt they could be better. And PG Harvey suggested me to introduce me to Flood. So I went there not really knowing what to expect. And what I found is, so Flood is, you know, he's done all my favorite records of the 90s. He's in his 50s now, I think. And I was looking for someone more of my age because I'd worked with Atticus and, you know, I felt, but actually, so I was coming with preconceptions, but actually what I found is someone that has had an extraordinary career up to this point. But to now, he's sort of in a space where he's unlearning everything he's learned, and which is a sign of for me of you know, endless curiosity and youth, because he's so untamed, you know, and I think it's not what I expected from a producer of that caliber. And he reminded me that when you're in the studio, Because studios are expensive, and you know, the economy of making records obviously is what it is today. It's not like in the 90s, but you're in a studio, you sort of start counting every hour, you know, especially when it's your money, because me and Jehnny Hussard paid for the record ourselves. And that I didn't realize, but was stopping my creativity, because I wanted to have a very productive day, you know, and make record the guitar part, then record the drum part, and then maybe tomorrow we'll do the bass, but the song will be here in 3 days. That's really not how Flood works. And I got really unbalanced. I got really taken aback by his attitude. And to a point where I got mad, you know, and I got mad to him because I was lost. I lost the song. I didn't understand what we were doing. We were recording things that were out of tune with each other, out of time. I didn't understand at all what was going on. And I was just losing control. And it suddenly, from someone who felt, oh, I love losing control, actually, yeah, I didn't. And it was interesting because he then pushed me away from the studio, asked me to go like for a walk or something and then come back. And then I came back and then he played me the song, like all the bits we had been doing and together and mixed it on the desk. And suddenly the whole song appeared to me and I was learning a new process of making records, which is not about having a result straight away, you know?
So he was kind of helping you unlearn your kind of habits, yes, as well. And how, you know, now do you look back and feel like that was an important lesson?
It's still with me now. Like, I'm writing new music now and I have Flood in my head all the time. I keep thinking, what would Flood say? What would Flood think? What would Flood do? So I think he's really, really touched me, and Jehnny Hussard as well. We both feel very, we've been very penetrated by his way of seeing the world and his way of, it really changed our perception of making music and art. And I feel very grateful for that. I feel he's probably launched me for another 10 years, if you know what I mean. It's probably, yeah. And I understand why artists like Polly work with him. I get it. I totally get it.
Well, if he's making you feel re-energized, then...
Yeah,
and you're thinking, like you say, what would Flood do? You know, that shows his influence and how important and how much you got from it. But I think it shows a lot because you didn't see it straight away, and because it was like we started this conversation about, you know, anxieties and relationships and how when things are changing or when there's a transition. Yeah. It can be very painful, but that doesn't mean you should walk away from it.
Exactly, exactly.
This is exactly that,
isn't
it?
Yeah, it's exactly that. It's uncomfortable, but it means you're learning and you're pushing something, and you can go back home and not bother. I mean, you can. You can be like, you know what, this is not for me. This is too painful. I feel completely unsettled. Or you can stay and see it through. And the weird thing about making an album, I think, and you probably know this, but it feels like you're in danger when you're absolutely not. But it feels like you're putting yourself in danger, which I can't really explain because it's on your bloody record. You know what I mean?
No, but and you do sometimes feel like, you know, when you're talking about music or a record, and then you think, wait a minute, it's just a record, but it's not, is it?
No.
You know, even if nobody hears it, to you, this is everything. So
yeah,
it is important. It's not just a record, you know, in context of your life and your mind and your spirit, this is not just a record.
Yeah. It's a continuation of who you are.
Outside of the record, do you think being in France, you said you're writing new music. Mm-hmm. Do you think going back to France has had had an effect on your art and how you're writing and how you're feeling going forward?
Well, I moved to France, 3.5 years ago. I'm in Paris right now. We also have a studio in the countryside, so we're back and forth basically since the confinement is over here. Me and Jehnny Hussard lived in London for 12 years. We moved back to France and for the first time in Paris 3.5 years ago, 4 years ago now. I needed a change. I needed to, this was all very unconsciously, you know, done unconsciously. I didn't really plan, thought about it that much. But I think when I think about it now, I think I needed to, I left France when I was 20 years old. I was obsessed with England. I was obsessed with, then I made my, I started my band, Savages. We toured all around the world. I had a lot of ups and downs. It was amazing, and but also very hard. And then suddenly I felt, you know, I had left behind a family. I left behind friends and my roots, you know, even my language. Because I always joke to say that I started speaking French with an English accent, which was pathetic. It's depressing. I was like, I'm born and raised in France, and now I'm speaking French with... what is this? Like, people think I'm English in France. So it was ridiculous. I was like, I've really run away from something, you know, and I need to understand why. So I came back. I this is a personal thing, but I started therapy and I think it helped. I think it was all about trying to go back a bit with, I felt like a fragmented self. I felt I had parts of me which were not connected, my younger self, my, you know, who I was as a kid, as a teenager, how I grew up. And it was impossible for me, for example, as an artist before this record, to talk about my parents or my family or how I grew up, who I was. I didn't want people to find out anything about it. But I secretly always admired artists who could. Artists who could say, my dad was this, my father, you know, my mother taught me this. And I always felt that was a very grounded artist who were able to do this and be able to acknowledge their roots and reconcile themselves with it as well, and admit that you are also a product of where you come from. I think that's what happened to me when I was 20 years old. I didn't want to be defined by where I was coming from, my nationality, my sex, my gender, my, you know, I didn't want to be, I wanted to be floating in the air, unattached to anything, which is fine, but because I managed to find something else.
But you feel like you got to a point where you feel like you wanted it was time to go to rediscover and, I guess, reimagine that you know, maybe it's not a bad thing to.
Yeah.
And like you say, going through therapy, you know, I've done therapy myself and will continue to do so.
Yeah.
Throughout my life, because it's been enlightening and amazing, you know, and similarly, you know, similarly looking backwards at where you came from is a big part of that, and
yes,
and understanding how it made you who you are, and that the good and the bad, and that can have a big effect on your creative side as well.
I think so. I think as an artist, it's important to know where you are, where you come from, and I didn't used to think that. But it's just, it's a matter of time. I mean, I just needed that to happen at that time, you know.
I didn't leave the city I grew up in, you know, so I joined bands and I went traveling and I'd been around the world a lot, but I kind of stayed grounded where I grew up. Mm. But I did have a definite separation from my family and felt like I had to go and become who, you know, work out who I was and what I was going to do. And,
absolutely.
And like you said, not be defined by where you came from and what people expect of you and whether that's your family or people, onlookers, you know, what they think you, who they think you are. You're like, no, I'm going to reinvent myself.
Yes.
But then I think that's part of growing up. And then as you get older, you think, actually, I'm very proud of where I came from. And I not only that, but maybe I haven't thought about it enough and maybe I need to explore more about it. And maybe I haven't given it enough thought, because when you're younger, you're a bit more immature, you know, you're not you're thinking very selfishly, very selfishly thinking, right, it's all about me.
Totally, totally. Starting every
sentence. No, it's not, is it? and maybe, you know, maybe your father getting ill and things like that, you know, they're a reminder.
Well, the funny thing is like, well, it's not funny, but my father getting ill happened at the end of that. I mean, not at the end, but I had done all this work before and I was chasing something. I wasn't sure what I was chasing. I was back to my home country. I was trying to find something. And then my dad being ill, sort of, I was prepared when it happened. Because it would have been awful if it had happened when I was still in the UK, still chasing something else, you know. Thankfully, yeah. It happened after 2 years of me being back in France and really trying to solve my issues with my family, trying to understand, trying to get closer. And then he got ill and I was sort of ready. I was sort of there. I was able to be there. And I think it happened, I don't want to say it happened at the right time, but it just happened that I was available in my mind.
A time when you was present.
I was present, yeah. And I was able to be there, yeah.
And that's not always, that's quite often the case. Not being present is about being there.
Yeah.
Mentally, isn't it? Not just physically.
Yes.
Being ready.
Yeah, being ready. Yeah. Being ready to love, you know, being ready to, yeah. Because I think that's what happens when someone gets really ill, is like people start to share love more. And I was ready to love more my parents. Yeah.
It just reminded me of a while back when you shared a single and the video included some
yes.
footage of you. And family footage, and you playing the piano. And yeah. I remember you That's saying hard. That it was, you know, really, really emotional and had such yeah. a big effect on you. And
yeah, it was done during confinement. So we had other plans for the video, but me and Jehnny Hasta were stuck in Paris in our flat and we did the video there. And it happened that I had this footage at home of me as a kid. And when I watched bits of it, I found that there was this moment of I was improvising on the piano when I was a kid. I'm about 10 years old. And and it happened that it was in the same tonality as the song.
That's crazy.
So I was like, this is funny. This is, yeah, it's like the best synchronicity ever. So I used it in the video.
Does that feel like, to me, it feels like such serendipity and like a full circle, you know, after everything we've just discussed and then discovering a, you know, childhood video of you playing the piano in the same key as your solo album, you know?
I know.
I've got really into photography over the last few years and I think a lot about the people behind the cameras, you know?
Yes.
I suppose since losing my mum and when I look at family photographs, I've suddenly now think about the person behind the camera, you know? So you see all these pictures of you growing up as kids but somebody took that picture, somebody took the time to do that. And that, you know, you wouldn't have thought that person as a photographer or a filmmaker, but they were capturing something that was so important that maybe gets missed as well. It's just about what's in it. And that made me think about that, you know, you're sat on the piano playing, but who's filming that?
Yeah.
Yeah, and who's deciding to capture that, and how important is that part of it, you know? And that comes back to, you know, talking about your family and rediscovering how important they are.
Yeah, and how important you are to them. I think I was shocked when I watched videos of me as a kid with my parents, because what I saw there was the love they had for me, which as a teenager and growing up, you don't know, you don't acknowledge that, the time they spent, the attention, the care, the sacrifices. You know, they spend time trying to read you a story. I mean, just that. I mean, I was lucky to have that as parents. And you don't know, because when you're 3 years old, you don't understand that effort. You don't acknowledge it. And when you rewatched it, it can be very emotional, because you're like, my God, they were holding me in their arms, literally. And that's a beautiful thing.
It's very deep. I wanted to just ask, you know, talk a little bit about the book.
Sure.
Calm, or C-A-L-M.
Yeah.
Depends how you want to
say it. Crimes Against Our Memories, yeah. Calm.
Yeah. I mean, was that something that you've been thinking about for quite some time, or it was very much you and your partner, Jehnny, exploring your life and exploring love and photography as well, you know, Johnny seems to just take his hand to anything. Whether it's making knives or taking photographs. I don't know where he gets it from. He just picks things up and goes, oh, look, I made a knife. Right.
I know.
But this seems like a real exploration of, you know, you two together, but also, you know, you've obviously always been a writer, but did the book, I guess what I'm asking is, you know, was this something you expected to do, or did it kind of come out of this kind of exploration?
Jehnny Beth is my partner. We've known each other for, we've been together for 16 years. So and we've been collaborating together since the beginning. So I'm amazed by his, you know, when I say amazed, it's like literally every day, you know. I'm really in awe about his creativity and what he's capable of doing, and also his struggle and his fighting to try to keep that alive, you know, to keep the mundanity of living doesn't, you know, take over and stop you from being an artist and being creative and finding new ideas. And part of that is also being very idle, you know, being sort of trying to find space. To do nothing, and that's how you create new things, because if you're always at it, then you're only repeating yourself. So what he's really good at is trying to find space, and he's fighting for that constantly, and sometimes it's a struggle, and I see him struggling and fighting for it, but he always finds it in the end. And I picking up a new medium, I think, is part of that. Because when he picked up a camera when we moved to Paris 4 years ago, it was a fresh medium. It felt completely liberating and fresh and exciting, and I loved his pictures. I immediately said to him, "You need to do a book. This, you don't realize how what you're doing is amazing." He didn't, and I think he could have created photography forever without publishing them ever. And I think part of our duo is me, who sees also the way we can bring those things into the world. So he inspires me. He's the fuel that makes me be more creative and be an artist, and he inspires me the nature of what it means to be an artist. The writing for me, to write a book, is 100% a childhood dream. I've always written since I'm a kid. I've always, you know, I wrote my first book, and, you know, I was always writing novels, you know, with big, you know. And I think even before I wanted to be a musician, I was a writer in my head, you know, projecting myself as a writer. So I think to see it on the shelves in a bookstore, I think is huge for me. It's a huge accomplishment. Writing Calm was definitely coming from from Jehnny's photos. And the fact that it was part of our lives to do sessions and obviously the photos are very intimate, and they talk about intimacy, the secrecy of intimacy and sexuality and fantasies, and it's a lot about women, actually. And women love Jehnny. He loves them and they love him. He has a great relationship with women, and a lot of them are friends of ours, but they're also friends of Jehnny's, you know. And they love talking to him. He's a great listener. He respects them. He loves them. He cares, you know. And I think the women are then very, I have a great trust with him. And all that happens in the book are things that they initiated. He never asked anybody to do anything. It's just part of conversations and, you know, people at the moments of their lives when they want to explore. And I found that really beautiful. And I was taking part in those sessions, but also watching, you know, and that special for me, I was the witness of something that I felt very liberating and free and exciting. And so it inspired me to write about fantasies, about those people. What would they say? You know, so the whole book is for me fiction. I wrote short stories, but they're all characters talking. So there's monologues.
But you're bringing your words are bringing Johnny's photos to life, giving them characters, stories.
They are
inspired by those sessions.
Yeah, exactly. But they're not directly, I'm not trying directly to bring a voice to a picture, but they are, if you bring them together, because they were done at the same time. And obviously the language I'm using and what I'm talking about in the book is compilation, let's say, of my own views on sexuality, my own experience, but also other people's voices.
And it's a really freeing and, you know, it shouldn't be a brave thing to do, but
I know.
In a world where people are scared of talking about sex and sexuality, it is a brave thing to do, to open up that kind of intimacy and personal, you know, your personal life. I mean, you put up a really good quote on Instagram, which I absolutely loved. The quote, actually, what you said was, "I'm often portrayed as an artist who talks a lot about sexuality. That's not true. I talk about life, and sexuality is part of life," which I think is such a beautiful quote, because that says it all, really. It's almost putting the problem back on the person who's judging you. Do you know what I mean? Saying, "Well, actually, this is not an issue. This is life. You're the one who's uncomfortable with it." And it's a really good way of looking at it. Although you're putting yourself out there to a lot of scrutiny potentially, I think I really admire that bravery from you and Johnny to do that. You know?
I know. I feel better by doing it, though, because it felt that for years it was sort of living in the closet almost, and now it feels like it's out there. You can choose to look, you can choose not to look. I remember jokingly Freddy from Massive Attack saying, "Oh, I love the record so much." And then he was saying, "The book I'm still scared to buy."
Which is great honesty.
I love it. And I was like, take your time. You don't have to. You don't have to. Of course, it's
missing out. You don't have to buy it.
Yeah. I was like, of course, you're missing out. But also, I get it. You know, I get it, but I think he was, and then he added, like, it's maybe part of my Englishness, and, you know.
Definitely.
I think brave is not the word. I love doing all of this, and it's, for me, it's not bravery, but it is in the world which, you know, scrutinizes and judges to sexuality and want people to conform, and the emphasis is very much on family, monogamy, you know, and all these conceptions of relationships and jealousy, romanticism, and we're even films and everything goes in that direction. So obviously when you're showing a different path, I think it can be seen as brave, because you're always the black sheep, you know, in a way. But I think it's done gracefully, and I think also it's done through art. I didn't write an essay about my own sexual life. You know, who cares? You know, I wrote fiction stories because I think imagination is the best place for it, and it's the best place for sexual exploration. It's the best place to talk about it, and it's a protection as well, you know. Fiction is also the best way to change the world. I think it does, you know, you trigger things with imagination that you wouldn't trigger with, you know, with real life or an essay, and writing an essay or journalism or, you know.
Yeah, it's much more, it brings much more fun to it as well.
Yeah, you know, absolutely. It was fun to write.
To fantasize.
Yeah.
Yeah. Was it, how did it feel when you saw it on the shelf?
Oh, it felt, you know what happened? I went to, because I can't go to the UK, right? I mean, I couldn't go to UK for months, but I went to, and the book is in English, so it's not in French bookstores, but it's in the English bookstores in Paris. So I went to Shakespeare & Co., which is an amazing bookstore with a great history. And I went to the guy because I couldn't find it on the shelf. So I went to the guy and I was like, humbly trying to say, "There's this book. I would like to see who's the author." And I'm like, "Oh," so I tried to say my name. And then he was sort of guessing it was me, but I wasn't saying anything. And he was like, "I can't find it. I'm so sorry." And I was like, "Oh, okay." Well, a bit disappointed, but I was like, "It's fine, you know." And then I leave the store, and then the guy runs after me and he's like, "I found it. Come back." And I was like, "Oh, amazing." So I went back. like, and he was like, I spelled it wrong, I'm sorry. And then I saw it and he could tell, he was like, is that you? I was like, yeah, it's me. Oh, no. It felt like we shared a special moment.
But that must have felt so great, like, because the first record you release is that feeling, and this must be the same. Is this the first book? This is the first book you've released, right?
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
And you hope to do more?
I hope to do more. I started writing a novel. I haven't touched it for like a couple of months. I started writing, so I'll go back to my draft and see if it's, you know, anything's good there. It's sort of a continuation of Calm, but with a female character, and I would just wanted to focus just on her. But right now I'm writing music, so I have to make pauses, but I'll go back to it.
What is the future bringing for Jehnny Beth?
Well, I mean, obviously we're trying to see how we could tour, how we could... still bring a show to people. So we're exploring a few ideas. I'm not really into the streaming, live streaming thing. I think a lot of people are doing that, and it seems to work brilliantly for some, not as good for others. But I'm not sure that's what I want to do. I'm trying to find an alternative. So I'm working on an idea for that. Hopefully we can proceed with it. Working on proper touring as well. In France, it might be possible before the end of the year. We're not sure. We'll see. And Europe, maybe early next year. But, you know, it's a plan B, plan C, plan D. We'll see.
I mean, it's hard to make plans, isn't it?
Yeah, we're making plans and then they always change. So.
But one thing you can do is keep creating, right?
Yeah, so I'm writing. Planning new episodes of Echoes. So there's a new episode that's going to be broadcasted in September, but we're planning to shoot more from October. If all goes well for the TV show, we'll shoot, we're trying to shoot more episodes before the end of the year.
See what happens, I guess. What we've learned is that we don't know what's going to happen.
Oh, and I've been enrolled in a new film, so I'm going to be doing a bit of acting.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, that's great. That's really good. I'm really happy about that. That was one of the silver lining of this year. Because I wasn't touring, this role came up. I got chosen and I wouldn't have been able to do it if I was on tour. So I was sort of happy about that, thinking, yeah, let's do this instead.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like there's been a lot of those moments over the last, not just this year, but over the last three or so years for you, you know, where things, you didn't know what was going to happen, but you know, the silver lining appears, and it's beautiful.
Every
things
day
happen.
Waiting for the good news. Any good news.
Yeah, exactly. Well, thanks so much for talking to me. I really appreciate
Thank
your time.
You so much.
I know you're busy.
No, I'm
it's
very
been really
happy.
Lovely catching up.
Very happy to talk to you, Stewart, and thank you for thinking of me. And well done for doing this, because I think it's great that we keep pushing things and doing things that keep us, you know, even chatting has cheered me up, you know. So
yeah, me too. It's been really interesting because I never really thought about doing this. A friend asked me if I'd do some podcasts for his website, and I thought, well, yeah, I really love chatting to people.
Yeah.
And I thought, why not rather than, you know, I don't want to interview strangers as such, but why not just speak to some friends and have a nice chat and see where it goes, you know. And it's been great for me. I've been really overwhelmed by the conversations, and it, like I said, it's just an excuse to talk, but it's also been really, really, really opened my mind to a lot of, you know, really inspiring conversations and thought provoking and a lot of mental health and a lot of talk about, you know, being honest about that stuff. Mm. It's been really good. So I appreciate your honesty and time, and I hope we can talk more without recording it.
Let's
catch up.
With pleasure.
Maybe a video call next time with you and Johnny. It'd be nice to see his face as well.
Yes. Yeah, we'll Skype you from the studio in the countryside and with the birds and the background.
Oh yeah, that sounds.
Yeah, it's quite nice.
That sounds perfect.
It's lovely.
I hope you have a really nice weekend, and
you
please send my love to Johnny.
Yes, and he sends his love, and speak soon, Stuart. Take care of yourself.
Yeah, I hope so.
Say hi to the band.
I will do. Take care.
Cool. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye. You've been listening to Keep Talking, a podcast brought to you by me, Stewart Baxter, and SOUNDSPHERE magazine. Thank you to my guests for taking part and to you for listening. Take care and stay safe.